Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, TX141 here, also known as Paul, bringing you another Ace in a Day gameplay for the Arcade Mode of War Thunder. In today's instalment, I shall be reviewing the I-16 Type 18 Ishak. To provide you all with a brief historical overview of the I-16 and the iteration depicted here in War Thunder, the I-16 was developed in the summer of 1932 by Politkov and his design team whilst they were in prison. The plane was designed in response to Stalin's call for a superior Russian-made, Russian-produced, Russian-designed fighter which was able to match, if not be superior to, all of the contemporaries available at the time by foreign nations. The design, first entering a prototype as of 1933 in the form of TSKB-12, was an incredibly prominent one. The initial test flights as of the 31st of December 1933, extending into the early period of 1934, depicted the plane as being brilliant in all regards. A high climb rate, a very high roll rate, great manoeuvrability, and a wonderful top speed on the level. This plane was even considered underpowered in terms of its engine, being powered by a Shvestov M22 engine, providing only 450 horsepower. This radial engine, however, was refined with time, and we will come back to that shortly. At the time of its introduction to service, as of May 1934, the I-16 was the fastest low-wing monoplane fighter in existence, being able to achieve on the level a top speed of 376 km an hour, or, in ye olde English, 234 miles an hour. What's more, the plane contained a couple of luxuries, including limited armour for the pilot and an enclosed cockpit. With that being said, the I-16 was to undergo its first test of combat during the Spanish Civil War of 1936-1939, due to the communist volunteers. The plane quickly picked up a reputation as being just as good as the biplanes featured and a good portion of the monoplanes on the battlefield. With the war developing, in 1937 the armament of the plane was increased from two 7.62mm ShKAS machine guns based above the engine to four of the same machine gun type. Additionally, the types featured in the Spanish Civil War started to incorporate the M25A Shvestov engine, providing 730 horsepower. Again, this was a radial engine. Nonetheless, with the arrival of the Messerschmitt 109B variant as of the latter period of the Spanish Civil War, the I-16 was beginning to become partially outclassed, and by the time of Operation Barbarossa in June of 1941, the I-16, still being a Soviet frontline fighter, was completely outclassed by the Emils and Friedrich types of the 109, despite a number of refinements to the engine and the armament. Still, that means that the I-16 goes down in history as one of the most prominent Russian aircraft ever made, which got to see combat service and its shining star moment as of the Spanish Civil War. The iteration depicted here, the Type 18, was constructed in 1939, featuring a Shvestov M62 830 horsepower radial engine, four 7.62mm ShKAS machine guns, and the ability to mount RS-82 rockets under the wings, and it was one of the very few types that could do this. With that rather lengthy historical overview out of the way, how exactly does the I-16 Type 18 perform in War Thunder? Well, that's a very interesting question, simply because this plane is a little bit out of the ordinary. We are indeed looking at one of the more manoeuvrable fighters for a battle rating of 2.0 as far as I recall. Additionally, you are also looking at one of the weakest fighters for its battle rating in terms of overall armour and durability. A couple of shots on this plane from machine guns or indeed cannon shells will cause you to disintegrate within a very short period of time. And dodging that incoming fire from a like-for-like plane as ourselves, we can see that we have to be very cautious. Pardon me. We have to completely understand that we are not a plane which can shrug off damage very easily, and as a result we have to be very subversive and pick our targets carefully. At the same time, pursuing the I-16 Type 18 Ishak here relentlessly can almost cost you your kill and indeed your plane. I almost got taken out by a combination of friendly fire from a plane behind me that I'd never identified and an I-15 coming directly towards me. However, our relentless pursuit of the I-16 in the end has caused them to catch fire and rip their controls to pieces, allowing us to achieve what I believe is our second kill. However, looking away from the negative side of things, let's go into a little bit more of the general schematics of this gameplay. We are on the ground strike map Eastern Europe, and the setup I'm using is as follows. Omnipurpose ammunition for the 7.62mm machine guns. I use omnipurpose ammunition because whilst the tracers can be a little bit more effective at setting targets on fire in my opinion, I feel that the omnipurpose ammunition allows for the greatest overall damage due to its combination of armour piercings and armour piercing incendiary tracers. What's more, I'm not looking to use my machine guns to do all the damage here, and as that H6K kill at the start of this game depicted, we have something a little bit different on this plane by comparison to my normal recipe. That's right, ladies and gentlemen, I'm mounting the 6 RSA-82 rockets, something I very rarely do on any aircraft, i.e. mount additional ordnance, and I'll come on to that in a minute. I'm using a 300m gun convergence, simply because if I'm going to get in close to attack someone, I want to make sure that my convergence is set accordingly. At long distance, the 7.62mm machine guns will do some damage, however, they're very ineffectual at sustained damage, by comparison when if you're up close. As I see an A20G off in the distance, and I know I've only got roughly a minute and a half to reload my rockets, this could be a promising rocket kill once again. However, I've digressed. I also have a 30 minute fuel load, and that is of course standard. And now we are going to return to the question of using rockets, as I descend on an SU-2 MV-5. Very quickly, as we get in closer and closer, we can do more and more sustained damage, grazing a shot over the top of our fuselage, and breaking away with an assist. We've already jammed a machine gun, despite the fact we have the new machine gun upgrade, and indeed quite a high weapon maintenance. I believe my weapon maintenance on this crew is roughly 50. As a result, you are reliving something quite historical to this aircraft, the machine guns jammed very quickly in reality. Having taken out the tail control of this Messerschmitt 19 ML1, and achieved our third kill, we break away and go for a reload. Returning to the concept of rockets, the reason why I use rockets on this plane is because of its lack of durability and the fact we have to be incredibly aggressive. This A20G comes directly for us, but we snap roll out of the way by performing a series of seesaw up and down motions, going into a climb, then a dive, and vice versa. Our spray allows us to achieve a little bit of damage on the A20, but they quickly collide with a friendly aircraft. The rockets mean that when I am confronted with the heavier targets, i.e. medium bombers or attackers, I do not have to flinch as much, and I can afford to go at them head on or in a beam pass at high speed and use my rockets to take them out, rather than have to sit behind it with my machine guns and try to take them out whilst maintaining distance from their gunners. I've found on a number of occasions I've just got to get hit once and my engine goes, or I lose a crucial part of my plane. Another A20G here tries to go head on with me with their rockets, however we prove the superior, due to our very small profile by comparison with theirs. I now break onto the back of another Messerschmitt 19 ML1, and very quickly I'm trying to close the distance, because as you see here, the further away we are, the less effective our machine guns are, and the greater proximity we have to the situation of a friendly getting in the way. In this situation, we've had to break off because we cannot close the distance. And so, we now move on to some of the advantages this plane has. As already discussed, historically this is a very manoeuvrable plane, and this carries through. This plane has got a roll rate comparable to, say, a Fokker 190 Anton. You will have little difficulty in out-rolling and out-changing direction by comparison with the rest of your foes. Your roll rate is comparable to the I-153, the Russian Chaika. What's more, because of this roll rate, you also have a brilliant turn circle. The light frame means that you can use your roll rate to change direction and close in on very tight turns. And we use our final rocket to rip off the tail of that Dornier 217J to achieve our ace. Quite a lucky shot. However, returning to the point, this combination of high roll rate and indeed sharp turn circle without the need to resort to your landing flaps means that unless you're going up against a biplane, in most situations you will be able to outturn your foe. There is only one monoplane which I feel can outturn you, and that is of course the Japanese KI-43 Hayabusa. A plane which can just outturn you thanks to its combat flaps, and if you resort to landing flaps, you gain an initial advantage, but remember, landing flaps are designed to bleed speed significantly, and this can put you out of the fight, as I will come onto very shortly in terms of weaknesses of this aircraft. You also have a decent climb rate, however this climb rate goes hand in hand with the nature of your aircraft. When the dogfights for the I-16 occurred, they were not at higher altitudes. If anything, they would be probably constrained to about 5,000 meters altitude or less, and you will feel this as I'm going to depict at the end of this game in terms of the engine. The climb rate is brilliant and comparable to most contemporaries, minus once again the KI-43 and perhaps even say the Spitfire Mark 1, up to an altitude of 3,000 meters. As soon as you hit about 4,000 meters, your climb rate disintegrates accordingly, and really you are trying to push the engine and the frame a little bit too hard. As a result, I will normally try to stick to dogfighting at no more than 4,000 meters altitude, using my rockets to assault enemy bombers if they're carrying on the level, but not trying to stay out there for too long. Whilst I'm trying to take out this lag-free 8 here, I panic, simply because I've got a lot of friendly fire coming in from behind, and I know really that if I get even one hit on my tail, it's game over for me. Again, the lag-free 8 comes around for a head-on, and we break over accordingly, trying to pursue them. I believe they've got no ammunition left, and that has resulted in us achieving our third assist. We go for another reload because we've got ample opportunity and time, and now I'm going to move away from the concept of altitude and come onto the overall acceleration of this plane. At speeds going between 200 to 250 km an hour, this plane will accelerate very well, and this extends all the way up to roughly 350 km an hour. However, pushing your engine above this is unnecessary in my opinion. You will have a lot of difficulty accelerating up to 450 km an hour as you start to move towards your top end speed. As a result, you'll find that this plane accelerates well in short bursts, going from low speed to medium speed quite effectively. As I say that, we managed to kill an SB2M to achieve kill number 6, putting our tally at 6 kills and 3 assists. I'm now depicting the climb rate of this plane as being quite sufficient as I break back up towards 1,000 meters altitude, if not a little bit more. Keeping my eye on an enemy down, and indeed, looking around for any future targets. We now come on to some of the weaknesses of this aircraft, and there are a number in accordance with the durability. On top of the durability, you have to worry about your fuel tank. Very limited hits to the fuselage, even if it's just a grazing 7.7mm round, will usually cause a fuel leak, and as a result, the 30 minute fuel load is always handy here. I've already said about the fact this plane comes apart easily, and the engine catches fire quite easily if hit, but on top of this, we also have to consider the fact this plane does not pack a huge punch. Whilst the machine guns may sound like you're actually attacking something with a garden rake or a lawnmower, in reality it's more of a case of sustained fire at close range is going to rip the target apart. The machine guns are not one-shot wonders, and so you are going to have to sometimes sit behind opponents and continue to put the rounds out, as I hope I've already depicted. The final disadvantage, of course, for this plane is its overall performance. Because the performance is limited to lower altitudes and the fact that really once you start heading about 4,000 meters, your performance drops off. It means that those of you who prefer an energetic style of play may find that the I-16 is constrained somewhat in this regard. We managed to set a Junkers 87D on fire, taking out their tail control as well, which means really they're just gradually heading towards the ground, and our efforts are now tangential, going for another target instead of focusing on a plane that's already pretty much dead. As we carry along, we also have to point out that another weakness of this plane is its overall performance with landing flaps, as I spoke about earlier. If you do decide to use landing flaps, you are going to find very quickly that you will bleed speed excessively, and as a result, this means that deciding to dogfight with them can actually cost you the plane, especially if you're trying to outturn, say, a biplane, or indeed the more maneuverable monoplanes. Landing flaps are decent for one or two turns, but they will soon cause your speed to drop accordingly, and as a result, you will have to either break off to pick up speed, or drop the landing flaps and hope to continue the fight with them raised. As a result, I would advise playing most of your time with the flaps raised, excuse me once again, simply because this will help you maintain your speed whilst you're dogfighting. Another point I'd come onto is the use of rockets. Now, as I said, they're quite central to my playstyle of the I-16 Type 18. How much of a performance change do they cause? Without the rockets, you are going to notice a little bit of a difference in terms of your climb rate and ability to pick up speed. What's more, the plane does not really sacrifice much of its turn circle with the rockets, and as a result your overall maneuverability is maintained, only at the cost really of a little bit of performance in the vertical, and indeed on the dead straight. Ergo, do not panic about having to mount rockets or if you decide to mount bombs, although I've yet to actually mount any bombs, so I cannot comment on this regard entirely. As a result, having discussed the overall performance in terms of advantages and disadvantages of the I-16, We're now going to come on to another little consideration as we go to rocket this Heinkel 111H3. Get in nice and close, and then releasing accordingly. The other consideration I'd like to get onto is the use of rockets in general. There's very little shakiness to the aircraft when you fire the rockets, and as a result, unlike my performance depicted here, you can usually pick off a medium to heavy bomber or indeed a large attacker with just one or two rockets if you catch them in a nice head-on. I will be covering the concept of attacking bombers with rockets and without them, of course, in a future TX's tip video, so I would not exactly use this gameplay here as the one all definitive guide. And I say that as I'm gradually climbing now away from a Ki-61, who's quickly turned their attentions towards a friendly Heinkel 111, and I'm now going to show how poor the climb rate of this plane is, and how poor its performance is as the altitude increases, as I make for a very futile attempt at chasing a H6K, which is very gradually bombing out our bases and sealing the game for the enemy team. Already up at 4,000 metres, we can see that we are trying to maintain our speed at roughly 300 to 320 kilometres an hour, and it's very difficult to continue to climb. If I had been flying, say, a Ki-61 or a Spitfire Mark 1 at this point, I would have easily started out climbing the I-16 due to the performance of those planes with altitude by comparison. However, no disrespect to the I-16, we have to just consider that this plane is limited in altitude. And my last point really is going to be about the manoeuvrability and speed envelopes. This plane seems to perform very well at all speeds, minus near stall. If you can keep the speed of this plane above 240 km an hour, you will be absolutely fine. And I try to keep my speed somewhere between 270 to 330 km an hour in all situations where I need to go into an extended dogfight. If you exceed 330, there's no real roll rate lockup at first, although once you hit about 600 km an hour in a dive, you're going to find the plane becomes very unresponsive and its smoothness dies off accordingly. At this point I'm actually typing to my team that I'm trying to chase after the H6K, which I've actually discerned is at roughly 7,000 metres altitude, and so what has started off as a valiant effort is starting to turn into something a little bit more depressing and drastic. However, as you're going to see, my luck just runs out. We should also say, oddly enough, and something I've not covered, the actual rudder of this plane. I've talked about turn circle and indeed performance in the vertical, but what is this plane like with a rudder? The rudder is incredibly sensitive, and as a result makes for a brilliant method of bringing the plane around a little bit faster, especially with that massive engine and very light airframe, which means that you can bring the nose around quite quickly by comparison with other aircraft at your battle rating. At the same time, however, do not see this as a means to continue to shake the rudder about at low speed. I've actually found on a number of occasions at say 250 km an hour or less, the rudder, if used extensively in order to try and level out the plane or bring it around into a very sharp turn, can actually cause the plane to shake quite uncontrollably. And as a result, you will have to put the nose down and build some speed up to force the control back into your hands. I've actually lost track of the H6K here, and I'm quickly trying to discern them in the sky. And I get the feeling that if I start pushing towards higher altitude, I'll see them again, and I just have. Over in the distance, roughly in the left-hand side of your screen, a little bit off-centre. I'm now up at 7,000 metres altitude, and as you can see, this has taken, I would say, roughly, by my estimation, 2.5 minutes to get up to this altitude, although I'm actually going to put a timer on the bottom of the screen in order to encompass this. Also to give you all an idea of exactly the climb performance of this plane. In reality, I wouldn't expect many players to actually do what I'm doing here, climbing after a float plane or, well, a medium bomber up at 7,000 metres in a plane that's not suited for this. I did this at the time not as an example, but actually as desperation in order to try and win the game, because I personally felt that the H6K would gradually bomb out the base, and I'm one of the only planes that can get up to this altitude in time and implement rockets. Although once again, I've actually implemented a poor rocket reload speed, and I've missed time this drastically, as now I'm having to pull distance on the H6K with its deadly rear armament of a 20mm turret in order to provide myself with time to reload my rockets. Ergo, we are not going to carry on with this discussion for much longer, simply because the time is almost coming to its end, the game is well into adolescence, and I can only really discuss some crucial tips. If you are going to fly this plane and intend to use it as an energy fighter, I would advise using your machine guns at close convergence and really trying to catch your opponents by surprise. Waiting for the last possible minute to open fire will allow you to implement maximum damage at very close range. This all ties in with a very tight convergence, and if you decide to mount some rockets, it can lead to some spectacular unguided kills. For the most part, as already stated, I use my rockets as a means to take down targets which are significantly larger, heavier and more destructive than myself, and that way I'm able to take a very light aircraft and essentially give it the weight that say a lag 3.8 would have, which 20mm cannon and its 12.7mm. The machine guns are fine, but remember, they're more like pepper spray in all honesty. They're going to blind the opponent and damage them temporarily, however the real delivery is going to be in the form of extra ordnance. Of course, I've seen a number of players, and I've done it myself, take out heavy, well not heavy, medium bombers using the I-16's machine guns, although it's very difficult by comparison. Now with that being said, let's take a look at some post-game stats. So, we can see that our 8 kills and 3 assists netted us 15,549 Silver Lions. On top of this, we earned 1,073 research points, with 322 of those going towards our research on the LA-7B20. We conclude this review of the I-16 Type 18 by realising that it is a plane for the pilot who is deft with the joystick. It is an aircraft which cannot take a punch, and indeed, if hit, is likely to catch fire or lose a significant portion of manoeuvrability, or, in worst case scenario, lose a lot of its fuel very quickly. However, if you can dodge incoming fire from both turrets and fighters alike, you will find that this plane can play into your hands considerably well. With its very tight turn circle, high roll rate, decent climb rate, and quite interesting acceleration on the level extending up to a speed of 350 km/h, this plane will play well to those who like to be in and out of the fray and minimise the risks. However, I would not recommend taking this plane above 4,000 meters altitude as depicted in the closing stages of this gameplay. As the altitude increases, your performance drops off. However, this goes with the time of introduction of the aircraft. What's more, to beat the I-16 Type 18, you can outturn it if you are flying a biplane. However, unless you are flying a very tight turner such as the Ki-43, the best means of beating an I-16 is essentially to boom and zoom it over very long, energetic distances. Because whilst the I-16 can climb well and accelerate well, it will not match up to the acceleration of, say, a Lag 311, or indeed an aircraft such as the Hurricane Mark 1, over the longer distance boom and zoom passes, which means an I-16 pilot will be frustrated as you wander off into the distance and come around after achieving quite a significant gap between yourself and the I-16. We can see by comparison the rest of our team that we came second, and we played to all of the strengths. And, thanks to our little bit of extra ordnance in the form of 6 RS-82 rockets, we were able to make sure that our little fighter could be just as deadly as a cannon-armed fighter when attacking medium bombers. As a result, if you're looking for a dirty little rat, which, if allowed to get in close, get in tight and catch an opponent by surprise, can rip its wings off with its terrible bite, the I-16 Type 18 Ishak is the fighter for you. And so I've been TX141, and if you've enjoyed this video, why not leave a like, comment or subscribe for future Wolf Hunter videos on my channel. Until next time, ladies and gentlemen, take care and good luck in the skies!